Hi everyone, Anthony Fantano here, the internet's busiest music nerd, here for another episode of On Track with TND, our ongoing interview series with the good people at Skype. And today's guest, from Hamburg, Germany, it's Danny Brown. Detroit rapper Danny Brown is an artist who I've been dying to do a formal sit-down interview with for a while. And that's because in the hip-hop landscape of today, I feel that he is one of the most unique artists walking, most unique artists rapping. And I feel like his latest album, Atrocity Exhibition, proves that even further, with it being one of the most envelope-pushing, dark, and tortured rap records, I think, to ever be recorded. So in this interview, I'm looking forward to diving into this new record with him and finding out what is sort of been making him tick as an artist over the past several years since he released his last record, Old. Hey, dude, what's up?
What up, man?
It's been a while since I've seen you. At least now I get to ask you a few questions, just kind of see what's going on with you.
Facts, yeah.
All right, well, let me start with your new album, Atrocity Exhibition. Are there any sort of like direct pieces of inspiration that went into this album like that? I mean, you know, I have a sneaking sort of suspicion that like, you know, and I know you're conscious of Old Dirty Bastard and I know you enjoy his music, but like when he was in the booth, you know, really going crazy on tracks and screaming his brains out. I mean, that sort of seemed to me to be like a bit of a piece of inspiration as well, you know, just like kind of create that same vibe, that same sort of insanity in the booth.
I mean, I wouldn't say I do it on purpose, but subconsciously, yeah. And this is like come from a lot of other people too, like Jonathan Davis from Korn, as funny as that probably is.
Oh, really?
Like how he used to do his vocal performances on Follow the Leader. Like I was a real fan of that. So I kind of like take from that too. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, he used to do his little rap thing, too, like here and there, you know?
Yeah. But,
and now he's, so I kind of, like, adapt with that. Even that's why Be Real was on the album, too, because Be Real was a huge influence on my flow and just that voice. Like, having that voice, I think I got that a lot from Be Real. So I was real honored to have him to get down on the album.
That was just a really aha moment for me, because even though I was conscious of Cypress Hill, when I finally heard him on your record, I was like, holy f***. Like, of course he's like an influence. Like, it would only make sense.
Yeah, Be Real is a huge influence. Like, that first Cypress Hill album, I listened to it religiously. Like, that was the days when you used to go buy, like, the bootleg tapes, 3 for $10. I remember bought, like, Cypress Hill and, like, TLC. And I don't know, I think it's Black Sheep, probably, something like that. And I listened to that album religiously. And then, like, you know, by the time, like, Dr. Green Thumb and stuff like that came out, like, I just super looked up to what they was doing. Like, even when they was just doing, like Soul Assassin stuff with DJ Muggs and stuff like that, like, they never really, being that they was from the West Coast, they didn't let they region, you know, like really dictate their music. Because you can put, like, Cypress Hill in the same bed as Wu-Tang, which I was listening to a lot at the time, too. So it wasn't that far-fetched for me to get into Cypress Hill. And then they had the rock influence too. You know what I'm saying? It was like a lot of genre bending. Like, they was like one of the first festival rap artists to me. So I really look at them as like trailblazers for that.
Yeah, it's sort of interesting. During that decade, there were just way more crossovers between rock and, between rock and hip hop. Definitely not as many as there are now. It kind of seems like even though in the internet age, culture is just really kind of bleeding into itself in a lot of different directions, it seems like rap and rock, that separator has come back and it's sort of like been like, no, we can't have these two worlds collide. And I think in a way it's kind of as a result of like, for whatever reason, people look back on bands like Korn and they're like, that was terrible. That was
awful. Yeah, I say Korn, I say we got to blame Limp Bizkit. It's all Limp Bizkit fault, man. It's all Fred Durst's fault, man. So we go with that.
I was going to say, I used to have that Follow the Leader CD.
Yeah.
And there's this, you probably remember it. There's that song on there where Fred Durst and Jonathan Davis have a rap battle.
Yeah, that's not the best one. That's not the best song that I have.
That track is so, but I know it's not great. I know it's not great, but like lyrically, that track is so f***ed up.
I didn't even like the song with Ice Cube either. I wasn't a big fan of the song with Ice Cube on there either. But
that song wasn't a high point.
I blame Fred Durst. But even if we want to look at it, we still had stuff like Rage. You know what I'm saying? Rage Against the Machine was great to me. And, you know, System of a Down had a little bit of hip-hop influences, I would say. So it has been good. It has been some good with Rage. But I think we got to blame Fred Durst.
One more influence that I would like to maybe get your words on that a lot of people have brought up just in relation to the title of the album. You know, are there some sort of J.G. Ballard or Joy Division sort of connections to be drawn here, obviously?
Of course, it's the Joy Division, but I never read the J.G. Ballard book. I skimmed through it. I looked at it, but the title come from the Joy Division song. Because, you know, people just start getting caught up into this world. I don't know. Like, I meet a lot of fans, and they'll just be like, they care more about, like, my actual lifestyle than the actual music. So it started making me feel like a spectacle or something. Like, people was taking it for a joke. Like, everybody expects to get around me, and I'm just going to be happy, and it's all going to be hunky-dory, and we're going to do drugs
together and have a party. But that's not what I'm about, you know? It's time to turn it down a little bit, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you were old when you came out with Old. Is there a chance of you doing, is there a chance of you doing a sequel, Older? Danny Brown, Older?
No. Because Old was really just all about going back. Old was about going back to like the Detroit state of mind stages. Like everybody talk about Old, and they just talk about Side 2. But you know, but really to me, the album could have stopped after Ready to Go. And then I could have put Float On at the end. But then what, you know? So I always had to put the icing on the cake a little bit, you know? Because it's like, you know, with rapping, you know, you can evolve and you can become another artist, but can you still go back and still have those styles? You know, like I want to still be able to be sharp enough to go and be able to do the low register voice, deep thought songs, and still be able to have the high pitched turn up, happy, funny songs, you know?
Yeah.
So I don't want to lose touch at either side. So I got to, you know, keep my sword sharp on each end.
You know, do you have a quick take on this perception that rap is just kind of a young man's game? Because I feel like that is slowly kind of melting away as the genre is aging and you have more rappers that are 40, 50 and sort of getting up there and still sort of at it and still talented. You know, guys like Busta Rhymes still bring an incredible amount of talent and technical skill to a track when he does an appearance.
I think it always was looked at like a young man's game, but I think it's a young man game, but it should be policed by the elders. You feel me? Like, we still need some type of, like, I don't know, we still need some type of guidance. You can't let, if it's a young man game and his kids,
then what's going to happen in the future, you know? Because I know me, you know, a lot of kids not growing up with fathers in their homes.
So hip-hops are their fathers. Some of these rappers are their dads. Like, Too Short was my sex ed teacher, you know what I'm saying? E-40 was my life coach, you know what I'm saying? Uh-huh. Wu-Tang taught me about religion, you know what I'm saying? It's like, so a lot of things I learned from rap music. So how could someone your same age teach you some shit? You feel what I'm saying? So when we got rappers, so now like you got a rapper like E-40 now who's 49 years old, about to be 50, you know? And he's still doing some pretty relevant stuff, you know? So I just think it's all on the artist. I think sometimes when guys start thinking like that, then you are that. You start feeling old, then you become old. But if you know, like me, I'm still playing video games, watching cartoons. So, hey, I don't think the bars is going nowhere fast for me. You know what I'm saying?
Do you feel like there's truth to the assumption, to the stereotype that younger rappers, younger artists out there, lyricism is just in the trash? Guys like Lil Yachty are saying Notorious B.I.G. is overrated, and you know, all that 90s stuff is old hat and we shouldn't care about it anymore, and we should just, you know, invent our own thing and do things by our own standards.
I guess I can't really speak on it in that sense, because, you know, I mean, I like some of it and some of it is whatever, you know, but I gotta give it time before I could just say anything. We'll see 5 years from now, you know. Because there'd be a lot of rappers that, you know, you look at and you praise, and we don't even listen to them right now. You know what I'm saying? So as far as that, it could be a trend, it could be a phase, or it could be something real. The best thing I could say for them is just they got to just put their money where their mouth is, because I feel like they just talk more than, you know what I'm saying, than show. So they got to stop talking and start coming with the product to, you know what I'm saying? Because all you do is make people listen to your music with a negative approach. You know, like you saying Biggie trash or whatever. Then I listen to your music, I'm expecting to hear something. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't. So the best thing for you to do is just put your, you know, just let the music talk for itself. You know, kids gonna always talk, you know, but They got to let the music, like I say, we'll see in 5 years. We'll see in 3 years, possibly. You know what I'm saying? So
we'll actually see in 6 months.
See, you give
it. Whether or not anybody's listening to their music.
You give it them 6 months. That's why, see, for me, I feel like I'm blessed in that sense where I can take 3 years to make an album, you know, and come back and still, you know, people still, same people that, you know, acknowledged me before still acknowledge me now.
You had a post recently on Instagram where you had said, you know, sort of the ideal artistic process, or at least your artistic process, you know, kind of involves this stage of disappearing out of the limelight for a moment to do your own thing, recollect, reinvent yourself or reinvent your sound in a way. And, you know, also as a result of that, you maintain a certain level of mystery, because there was a while there where everybody was like, where's Danny Brown? What's Danny Brown doing? Like, you know, what's like, what's going on with this guy? We haven't heard from him in a long time. You know, how important is that part of the process to be able to kind of sit back and just unplug from all of it?
I think I just have that from growing up in Michigan. You know, we have that 4 to 5 months out the year where we can't go outside because it's so cold and we have to hibernate. So I think
that's just instilled in me from where I'm from. So I know in those 4 or 5 months, I'm going to be stuck in the house. What else am I going to do but work on music? You know, so I just get to the point where I'm just piling up. Like, even after this tour, as soon as I get home, I'm just going to start back messing around and seeing what I got, because I don't know how long it's going to take for me to make the next one. So I might as well get going as early as I possibly can, you know?
You know, with your growth in popularity and the success that you've sort of gained so far, has it been easy for you to sort of maintain a relationship with your home city and just sort of stay in touch with Detroit, at least in the respect of it's where you live or where you're living, and it's a place that inspires you?
I mean, for the most part, like, I don't really hang out in Detroit too much. Like, I go see my family here and there, and then most of the friends that I have, like, they're music friends too. Like, if I go on tour, they on tour with me. So most of the friends that I have, I'm with them all the time. So that's a different story, you know?
But for the most part, when I'm at home, man, I'm so tired, I just want to hang out at home and just, you know, hang out with my cats, you know, and play video games and chill, you know? So as far as that, though, I always just, like, try to go and check out and see what the younger guys doing in the music scenes, you know?
Like, I might every now and then pop my head up at a certain little music spot that I know that's happening just to see what's going on. But for the most part, I don't really hang out too much. Detroit's pretty dangerous.
If you let it be, you know? So I know how to be like Batman, you know what I'm saying? You got to be like Batman in Detroit, you know?
We're going to bring in a few guest callers over here that are going to ask you their own questions.
Hi, I'm Mike from Birmingham.
Ah!
We got the homie Mike in the house. What up, man?
You look ready for Christmas.
Yeah, he is looking really festive. Yeah.
It's real cold in Germany, man. You have to stay warm out here. Yes, I'm in Germany. I'm in Hamburg, you know?
Gee.
I won't
talk about all the opportunities for fun in Hamburg. Let's just leave it there, shall we?
I know. I already know you know.
How you doing?
I'm good.
I wanted to ask you a question, if that's all right. Congratulations, by the way, on the album. It's the work of an insane person, right? I mean, it's crazy. Oh, I love it, man. I love it.
Thank you, man. You know, you're a huge influence.
I feel like when you came out, like, it sounded, you obviously, you brought the way that you taught, you just felt like Detroit, you know, you brought all the Detroit stories straight out into people's faces. But it feels like with this one, you've brought the music, the experimentalism of Detroit.
That's what I was going for. So
I'm glad you was able to see that, because that's exactly where I was going for with it, man. Thank you, man, for sure.
Does your dad still have any synthesizers?
Nah, man. He don't. He kind of fell off with it, but he's been trying to get back in it. He's been collecting vinyl again.
Been back spinning a little bit, so yeah. So he's been trying to get back in it. But nah, I wish he did still had an
old school Roland 808, all that, but I don't know.
Yeah. So how long is your your German tour?
I go to Copenhagen tomorrow. I've been out here for, I've been in Germany probably for like a week, maybe. I don't know. I think maybe about a week.
I couldn't help but really, really laugh when I saw the Schoolboy, the video that came from Schoolboy Q. Are you all right talking about that? Because that was
Me and Q is what, you know, Q is one of my best friends. So every time I'm always with him, he's like the wrong instigator. He got me drunk like that on purpose. Like we went to go have lunch. And they say I know he had me drinking these big cups of Hennessy. So he set me up. Kinda. He set me up. That's like one of my best friends. You know, I went on tour. I went one of my first long tours with Q, and we shared a tour bus together, so we just been connected.
Dude, that grill. Ask about the grill.
What about the grill, Danny?
Oh, this is actually I got a newer one now. You know,
a newer one.
Got a new one.
Wow.
There's the thing.
I mean,
do you feel like you're losing a trademark there when you have it in?
I know they treat me better at the airport, so.
Better treatment at the airport.
It's pros and cons, you know.
Before you go, when are you guys coming out with the collab album? Is my first question.
Oh, yeah. The mixtape's dropping like next week.
Okay.
Yes. You know what I'm saying?
If it's next week, you already have the title, right?
All we need is 3 days. Yeah, what a time to be dead.
He's going to be here like in 5 days. And on the sixth day, there'll be a mixtape. So did you get that jumper in Germany?
Yes, I got it from just Benetton.
Gee! endorsement to follow.
Growing up, Mike, man. Growing up, I can't be wearing a hoodies and a t-shirt no more.
I'm very proud.
You know, I'm ready to whip out the sport coats and the blazers, you know what I'm saying, with some nice loafers, you know? Got to dress for the job you want.
Listen, next time you're in London, hit me up, seriously, because I want to teach you how to cold filter Nurofen Plus.
Yeah, man, please. I'm definitely with it, man. I'm definitely with that, man. You're sure going to be back in London, you know, and hopefully around springtime or something, man.
All right.
I want to move to London, man. I was actually thinking about getting an apartment out there, man.
Listen, come. We got a spare bedroom. Come and stay in our spare room.
Mike, thank you for coming on. We're going to bring in
our next guest.
Hell
no
yeah,
problem.
Mike.
Good to
see you again, man. We'll link soon.
Hell yeah.
All right, next we have a few questions from Tavares from Ohio.
What up, Tavares?
Not much. Great show at the Grog a while back.
Thank you, man. Y'all got great hot dogs in Cleveland.
My question for you was, what pushed you to keep creating and going the most when things got kind of dark?
I guess that's like my only release. Like maybe if I was like had like a therapist or like was able to do things like that, but I don't know that stuff like that. I don't think we do stuff like that being where we from. You know what I'm saying? We don't go to psychiatrists or therapists or shit like that. So the only way for me to get it out is to, like, make music. Because, I mean, for that 30 seconds you in the booth, you ain't thinking about no problems. And you know, a lot of the same, like probably the same shit people get from drugs, you know, where they can just do something and it just blind them to it, you know? If I'm in a booth recording a song or if I'm on stage performing, for that time, I'm not thinking about no problems. I'm not thinking about what's going on. So it was an easy escape. It's an easy way to release and get stuff out. So even if I wasn't, like, you know, like a rapper or whatever, I still try to find some artistic where I can just like get out. You know, I'd probably be doing boxing or something. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? I just got to get some type of release, you know, and rap music is my release. That's probably why I rap the way I rap. I'm in the booth damn near dying half the time. You know what I'm saying? I could barely breathe, you know. That's what a lot of people don't understand. The way I rap with that high pitch, that's me holding my voice. That's me holding my breath. So it's like I'm choking myself half the time, you know. So I die for this shit, I guess.
Hey, keep going. That atrocity is definitely best thing I've heard this year.
Thank you, man. I worked hard on it, man. So I just, you know, I'm just humbled that everybody else liked it, man, you know, because it was a risk, you know, for me, I felt like. So I'm glad everybody liked it.
Was there a specific turning point in your life or something or someone that sparked, like, your artistic passion?
I mean, I always wanted to be a rapper, but I guess the most important part was when I went to jail, you know, because before going to jail, I was, you know, I'm a music nerd like everybody else, you know, in this room, obviously. So I want to listen to music all the time, and I want to listen to whatever kind of music I want to listen to when I want to listen to it. And going to jail, it wasn't like that. I couldn't listen to it. I was listening to the top 40 radio, whatever they play on the radio, that's all you could hear. And then I would get these magazines that would, that was like when Ghostface Fish Scale came out, and I would just read a review on Ghostface albums, like, I can't, like, in my head, trying to figure out what this could possibly sound like.
That was such a good album to miss.
No, I mean, I got it when I got out of jail, but it hurt my heart to not be able to hear it, you know?
Well,
so I was like, if there's one thing that fucked the jail made me, I'm never coming back to this mother is, because I couldn't listen to the music that I wanted to listen to. And that hurt my heart more than anything. So I think that drove me creatively. Because then now I had to get creative in my own way to try to be able to figure out what was still going on in the world to get out and still be able to rap and not sound like I got left behind.
Tavares, thanks for coming on and asking your questions, dude.
Thanks for having me, man.
Transition. You've been watching On Track with the Needle Drop. Our guest today was Danny Brown, and if you want to watch our first episode featuring the great Alice Cooper, click over here. And don't forget to stay tuned for more episodes on this YouTube channel.